All right, so let's start the arduous process of Google Vertex. There is a basic setup overview that I put together that's pretty dang good, if I'm gonna say anything, on the GitHub. This should give you everything you need to set things up, but this doesn't tell you how to make the accounts to begin with. You can get away with just using this without making the accounts, but it's probably beneficial to make the accounts. So we'll go online, and I'll show you the links that you need to click on to start the process. So let's get to it. All right, so here we are in the Google Cloud dashboard on the browser. This is the alternative method of setting up a project. I don't recommend this. We can do this all from the CLI, and it's just gonna be easier. They try and hide the CLI from you for some reason, but not too well. It's there. It's in the SDK, and we'll go through the CLI. This, we'll just do this really quick just to show that the option does exist. When you go to the Google Cloud start page here, oof, man, you see right here, you have, this is your project. So you can click on that, and then you can go ahead here and click new project, and that's going to open up something like this. And you can go here to your first project. It's going to give you the project name, the project number. That's what you want to keep track of, and the project ID. You can add people here, and if you go to the IAM and you click on that, you can add permissions, which you're probably going to want to do. So that's the dashboard. I'm really not going to go into too much about this because it's extremely complicated, as dashboards are. I think the purpose of dashboards being complicated so that you have to hire someone to do it. I think that's really, they're kind of hooking people up because it's not that hard to use, but you can't figure this out in a day. This needs to be your job. So I think that's really what it comes down to. If you have a business that requires Google Cloud and the dashboard, you really need to hire somebody, or you have to spend a significant amount of time managing this yourself. It might be better for everybody if you have a dedicated person doing this. So that's the dashboard. Let's go to the CLI, which is the better option. All right, so first thing, let's just get deleting a project out of the way, because you might need to do that. So to delete a project, obviously this is the process. You select a project. We're gonna do this one here. Go ahead and select that, and we'll go to the IAM, and we'll go to settings, and then you have to shut down here. It's gonna make you copy this, put that in here, shut down the project. It's pending deletion. And just to make you feel uncomfortable, it's gonna show you all of these and say resources pending deletion. And that's what you wanna click on. So I have two projects that are pending deletion, and they will be deleted in the future. I guess there's some kind of garbage collector for some reason. So that's how that works. But that's deleting a project. Let's actually get to the CLI. And so that's the dashboard. We're done with the dashboard. I don't recommend using this at all. All right, so we're on a virtual machine. It doesn't really make a difference what we're on, but this is a Debian, and we'll work the same. First thing we're gonna want to do is set up the CLI, and that's gonna be a series of commands. It is in the tutorial on GitHub. So first, we'll go ahead and update everything here. Cool, let's just double check that and then we wanna install the certificates. Install the certificates here. Transport-http, there's no way I can copy, type this out without any. Okay, so that should get us the certificate. Okay, cool. All right, and then we want to go to the link that has the keys, and we should google.com/apt/doc/apt-key.gpg, right? GPG, and then we want to pipe that to sudo /gpg-o /user/share/keyrings/cloud. Oops, spelled that wrong. I'm spelling things pretty correctly so far. GPG. That, if this works, that's really an amazing thing that I've rarely been able to do. All right, so that did go through. And then we have this command, which is quite the extensive one. So we're going to pass the key to the T, and then down, and then just verify the keys basically. You can get away with not doing the keys. It'll just give you a warning But when you update, it's going to say that the key doesn't exist and you'll have an error in your when you sudo apt update. That is annoying. And it potentially will not update at all. Let's say keys unverified or something like that, and just cause you headaches. So you are going to want to do this. That should be good. Then we want to pipe this. And I mean, again, this is really that hopefully. All right, cool. That actually went through. And then curl https://, thing going on. Okay, cool. So it did verify that. And now that is the repository has been added. So then we want to actually install the package. Okay, very good. It has done it. Almost half a gigabyte. It's over half a gigabyte. That's so now. We can check the installation with gcloud version. There we go. So we have installed that. We are good to go. All right, if you're on Windows, there should be an installer. It shouldn't actually be that bad. And we're going to go ahead and keep that. And we're going to go ahead and open that. And we'll go ahead and run this. And we'll just leave that as is. We'll agree. Single user. I only have one user, so it's fine. In here, it's less space actually. The beta commands, we'll go ahead and add this because I don't know what that is. And I like adding stuff, even though I didn't add the other thing, that probably was helpful. So that's it. It's an installer. There shouldn't be any issues here.
Sometimes quite nice. I hate on Windows, but reverse engineering if the installer exists. That's fantastic. A lot of times with some of these services, the installer doesn't exist, and they want you to, try and build some source or something like that, and you're stuck with a PowerShell, and PowerShell is fine, but you can see here the commands for PowerShell are basically sentences, so it takes forever to type things out. And you're not Bash, so you can't do a script. You can do a script, but it's the same thing. The commands are just annoying. So that's what's going on. So we're gonna just let this run. And also, you can't delete folders. That's really my main gripe with Windows. You can't delete the program files folder, and I'll never forgive them for that. Because one time I really needed to, on one of my computers, I'm running low on storage, and I just want to delete all the programs. I don't want to restart the system because I want some of the files that I have on there, but I don't want any of the programs. I want to keep the files, and I want to delete all the programs. And the only way to do that is to delete each program individually. When I should just be able to, I've installed all the programs into a single location. Just let me delete the folder. But no, you can't do that. That's really my only complaint with Windows. You can, but it's not just a permissions thing. You gotta be in PowerShell, and it's a whole mess. So, you don't have full, you're not the super user. I don't know what kind of user you are on Windows, but you're not the super user. There's someone above you that doesn't exist, that has controls that you don't have access to, and you can't give yourself those permissions. So you have to, it's kind of annoying. Oh yeah, turn the firewall off, because I was doing some networking things. If you go into my GitHub on the reverse engineering folder, there's some stuff relating to networking that might be useful. And anal is short for analysis. This is pretty good. I should probably do a video on this, but I definitely recommend going through this. It'll get you up to speed with a lot of the networking stuff. So, not really networking stuff, but just sending communications and monitoring a separate network, which I didn't know how to do, so I'm glad that we went through that. Okay, so that's done. We're going to finish that, and it went ahead and did that. So now I have to log in, and the login process is going to open up another window, but I am not signed in.
No, I'm not. So it's not, I don't want to log in on here because I don't have the passwords memorized, and I'll have to copy them from somewhere else. But that's basically it. For Windows and Ubuntu, that is how you set up the CLI. You either use the installer for Windows or you add the repository and download the repository through Ubuntu. So it is harder on Ubuntu technically, but it's more direct, I guess. So yeah, let's move on. All right, moving on. Here we are in the collab. It's going to be the same thing, whatever you're on, except you will just have to do this in the CLI or the CMD. And if you're on a Mac, it should be essentially the same as Ubuntu, except the install, yeah, it's going to be basically the same thing. It's going to be basically the same thing. They give you a bash script instead of doing the commands, so it's kind of easier, but it's whatever. You go ahead and pip install this, and then you gcloud init, and that's going to ask you to do some things. You can reinitialize with default as opposed to creating a new. Either way, you're going to make a default one, so just hit one. And then it's going to, so I guess we should run this again. Just so you can see it. So since I'm reinitializing with the default, the creating a new project is going to be a, you can, here you're not going to have the option, so it's going to ask you to log in with a new account, but I've already done that. So it'll open up a new window and it'll bring you to a page like this, and you just copy the key and paste the key inside the prompt. Very simple. And if you want to create a new project and you've reinitialized, you are just going to want to go back to the dashboard here. And it's extremely simple. You just click here, new project, and it'll set up a new project for you. It's very simple. Just put the name in. This is a lot easier than doing it through the CLI. In this one instance, the dashboard's useful, so go ahead and do that. I'm not going to. And once you've done that, or if you already have a project, the one I'm using is LangGraph Test. We'll go ahead and hit one, and we're good. So now you can go ahead and run gcloud projects list, and it should list all the projects. Again, I deleted two of them. They're pending deletion, so they show up on the dashboard, but they're not. They're waiting to be deleted. And you don't have to run this because it's already been set, but if you do run it, it'll do what you want. And this is what you have to do. So you have to, this is the authentication. So instead of a key, you run this command. And again, these are all the instructions on the GitHub. Once you run this command, it's going to bring you to the page that I was talking about before again. And you just go ahead and click here, copy link address, and it'll have you sign in and you continue. You can add a flag that's --no-browser, and you can do this all from the CLI. But that's just going to require you to copy and paste more things. So I do a little combination of browser, dashboard, and command line interface. There we go. It's set up. And here we are using Gemini 1.5 preview. I'm not sure why this comes out to be free, but it does. So when we run this, there we go. Right. So this isn't, again, if you remember from the previous video, a better way to do this is to set up a prompt, or using a prompt template or the chat prompt template, and defining a human role and a user role and a system role. But this is a more direct and faster way to do it. So just kind of put this in here. But it works. It doesn't have access to real-time information. If I added a tool, which I can do because ChatVertex AI is one of the tool calling methods. Now you can use tools with non-tool calling methods, as I've mentioned a few times. But this is going to allow you to put this in a graph. And since the Gemini models are cheaper, and I find them to be pretty comparable to OpenAI for certain tasks, I think it's pretty good at code, at least as a starting point. It gives some interesting code outputs, usually a little more concise and cooler, you know, composition, function compositions and stuff like that. It does more of that. So as a true pipeline, if I'm just using the browser, or really using anything, I'll usually start with coding in Gemini, and then I'll pass the Gemini code to OpenAI and have OpenAI clean it up with the changes that I have noticed are not effective or additional features that I want to be added. So that is basically how you set up gcloud. And once you've set this up, you just put it in wherever you want. You've got the model. I could have called this LLM, which is what I was calling them before. This would just be model, I think, is the convention here, because the LLM would be, we're setting this up all at once. Usually, you wrap the LLM in the chat model, but not always. It's for OpenAI, it also is the same thing, but whatever. So that's how you set that up. It was hard to get the tutorial, to put the tutorial together, but once it's together, you shouldn't have too much trouble. So there you go. Peace.